Well, it's an early spring day today and a bit chilly outside. But inside, it's warm and comfortable. Let's take a look at the heating display. Not freezing outside, but not warm either. Anyway, it's a lot warmer in here. And the best part is, we're not using any energy for heating today. Do you want to know how that works? In this video, I'll be talking about our home's extremely energy efficient central heating system.
Hey, welcome back.
I'm Jordan, and I live here in central Japan with my wife and two kids. About 2 years ago, we wrapped up construction on our new house here. What an adventure! I video blogged the whole process, so feel free to check out those previous videos if you're interested. Now, let's get started. Anyone who's lived in Japan knows that houses here are generally quite cold in the winter. Central heating is extremely rare, and few homes are properly insulated. Traditional Japanese homes were built with summer in mind, so they could be easily opened up to let the wind flow through and keep everyone cool. As for winter, which can get pretty cold in most of the country, people kept warm by huddling around central sources of warmth, like heated kotatsu tables or wood or gas-burning stoves. But as a Canadian, I grew up with central heating, and I just really wanted to feel comfortable in my own house, even in the winter. So when my wife and I decided to build our house here, temperature control was a part of the plan from the start. And luckily for us, central heating as a concept is starting to catch on here, as is the use of insulation. It's just that neither of these has become standard practice at this point. So you can get a fully insulated, fully centrally heated home, but it's considered to be a luxury option. So you're paying for a luxury option. There are a range of heating options to choose from these days, but most of them are either quite energy intensive to run or just really expensive to set up in the first place. So we checked out the various options. And in the end, we went with the system that was recommended to us by the construction company we'd chosen to build our house.
The system, known locally as OM Solar, works by circulating solar heat through the house to keep it warm. Let's take a look at how this works. First, we head upstairs under the roof. This space up here is the OM Solar Nerve Center. Basically, the system works like this. The sun is shining. Special panels on the roof absorb heat from the sun. Not the same as photovoltaic panels. We got some of those too, but they're actually optional in this OM system. Anyway, air gets pulled in under these heat-collecting panels on the roof and through an intake duct into what's called a handling box. This thing sends the heated air where it needs to go, depending on the season or temperature. In the summer, we don't want the extra heat, so the air just gets vented out that way. But in the winter, the heated air goes through this duct here, all the way down into a kind of heat sink under the house. Let's follow it down.
Yeah, that's a storage closet now.
But if we follow that duct right down to the bottom, we end up in this space down here. Basically, it's just a layer of concrete with a small airspace above it, insulated around the edges and on the underside to prevent heat loss. So then, the trapped heat just does what it does naturally and rises up through a series of carefully placed floor vents on each level. This one leads upstairs. There are some situations when we close it, like when we have the AC on up there. But most of the time we leave it open to let the air move through. Well, let's head up there now. We'll take the stairs.
And because the concrete down there absorbs some of the heat, the warm air keeps trickling up even after the sun goes down in the evening. So the evening can be actually one of the warmest times of day. So what happens to the air once it comes up here? Well,
there's a filtered intake vent here in the living room to pull air into the system and keep it circulating, as well as other intake vents in each room to pull fresh air in from the outside as well. The system keeps the air moving through the house in a way that will optimize the internal temperature. On colder days, cycling the warm air from under the roof, and on warmer days, it pulls in the air from the cooler north side of the house into that space under the first floor of the house, and then cycles that around. This may not have much of a noticeable effect during our scorching hot summers, but in the between seasons, it just helps to keep the house comfortable any time of the day. Aside from the air circulation hardware and design features of the house, the other key part of the system is insulation. From what I could tell during construction, the insulation installed in the walls is on par with North American standards. Windows are double-paned, and for the larger ones, even the frames are specially insulated using a design similar to that of a thermos. Other versions of the OM system also include solar heated water, underfloor heating, and even central cooling as well.
For our place, we went with the most basic system. We also decided not to put in any gas appliances, so we have an all-electric home. This is a popular choice in Japan these days, since gas use for heating and cooking is a major cause of fire here, especially during our frequent earthquakes. On to the next topic. Let's talk about the financial side of things. What it costs to build a house like this, and what our monthly energy costs are.
The average construction costs for a new home in Japan these days is from 20 to 30 million yen. Building an OM solar house adds around 300,000 yen to the total cost, which is something like a 20% increase. This extra cost is due to the hardware necessary for the system itself, as well as for higher quality building materials, including the insulation and upgraded windows that I mentioned earlier. And also because of the very specific design specifications to allow the system to work properly. The price goes up further if you add extras like underfloor heating or central cooling, both of which would be nice, neither of which we can afford.
But anyway, one of the things that really appeals to me about this style of heating is the elegant simplicity of it. Adding more gadgets just seems like it kind of defeats the original purpose of the design. Adding the solar hot water heating system wouldn't have actually cost very much more. But since it's not sunny every day, you still have to install a separate gas or electric powered heating system, which just doesn't appeal to me as a concept. The only extra we went for was adding the solar panels, which of course added to the final price tag. But it seems like a decent investment since it means that the local power company pays us for energy rather than the other way around. We still have to pay for power sometimes, especially on cloudy or rainy days. But overall, we come out ahead.
In our old house, we spent about 15,000 yen a month for electricity and 17,000 a month for gas. Of course, this fluctuated a lot by season, but this is giving you the monthly average. And in our new place, you can see that our monthly costs are quite a bit lower. We probably still use an average of something like 10,000 yen a month in electricity, but we also generate a similar amount, which we sell directly to the local energy utility. Again, this varies a lot seasonally, but this is our monthly average. So we've talked about the costs of our heating system and the benefits as far as energy savings, but how about the actual performance? What's it like actually living here?
In the summer, the temperature outside can get up to the high 30s, So we obviously have to use the air conditioning then. But we only really have to run it for a couple of hours. And then as long as we keep everything closed up, the temperature stays pretty constant. In our old place, we had to keep the AC running 24/7 during the hottest time of the year. So the situation now is a lot better. Of course, it would have been cooler and simpler if we'd gone for the full central cooling option. But I'm not sure if it would have been worth the extra expense. Spring and fall are mostly great. As long as it isn't raining heavily outside, we just keep everything opened up if the weather's warm, and the OM system helps by venting any unwanted hot air out through the roof. And if it's a cooler day, the system just quietly does its thing and raises the internal temperature up a degree or two. In the winter, okay, I should just mention again that I grew up in a place where even if there's a meter of snow piled up outside, it's still warm inside. I mean like t-shirt warm. So does this home live up to a Canadian standard of climate controlled comfort? No. The heating system works subtly. Especially first thing in the morning, it can be a bit chilly inside. And it doesn't really start to warm up until the sun heats up the roof and gets the OM system going. Here's an example of our display panel from a couple of days ago.
0 degrees outside. We even had a little snow that day. Inside, it was 13 degrees in the morning, which isn't all that cold, I guess.
But it isn't warm either. I usually have to put on a fleece jacket over my pajamas when I wake up in the morning. But once the system kicks in and the warm air starts circulating, the temperature comes up nicely. And it usually stays warm for the rest of the day. The problem is really just those first couple of hours. And then there are those cloudy and rainy days where we just don't get any sunshine. On days like this, we end up using our wall-mounted heater, the same unit as our AC. Without sunlight to get the OM system moving, it's not gonna warm up the house. I guess that's why everyone recommended the underfloor heating option.
From the point of view of energy efficiency, I think our heating system scores pretty high. But if you're just going for bang for your buck, there are probably other systems out there that offer better value. I'm sure you could just put really good insulation into a standard, modern Japanese house, give it some underfloor heating, and you could get a comparably warm home for less than what we paid. Especially if you're going with a major construction company that uses factory mass-produced prefab components in construction. Which is how things are normally done in Japan these days. But if you've watched any of my earlier videos, you'll know we went with a smaller local company that specializes in traditional wood-based construction and customized home design. One of the things we liked about this company was their philosophy that home design should optimize not only use of space, but also airflow, lighting, humidity regulation, and temperature, based on the layout and materials used. This makes it hard to separate the cost of the heating system from that of the construction as a whole. So even though we might have been able to build a warmer or cheaper house, I wouldn't trade it for what we got instead.
Thanks for watching. If there's anything in today's video you'd like explained in more detail, please leave your questions in the comments section and I'll do my best to answer them. Also, if you still haven't watched the previous videos in my home construction adventure series, I recommend you do so.
And finally, if a weird mix of construction projects, Japanese cultural content, and beer travel doesn't appeal to you, you probably shouldn't subscribe to my channel. But if it does, see you in the next video. Kanpai!